Good morning, Skillman family. This is Rio Behar, and I am so happy that you are able to tune in so that we can be together this morning. We may not be together physically, but we can be together in spirit and in unity together. I love you all. If you are tuning in for the first time, welcome. So glad you're here. And if you're tuning back in from all these times we haven't been able to meet, welcome back. Love you guys. Love my Skillman family. I'm going to be reading today from Psalm chapter 8. O Lord, our Lord, how majestic is your name in all the earth. You have set your glory above the heavens. Out of the mouth of babies and infants, you have established strength because of your foes, to still the enemy and the avenger. When I look at your heavens, the work of your fingers, the moon and the stars which you have set in place, what is man that you are mindful of him, and the son of man that you care for him? Yet you have made him a little lower than the heavenly beings and crowned him with glory and honor. You have given him dominion over the works of your hands, and you have put all things under his feet, all sheep and oxen, and also the beasts of the field, the birds of the heavens and the fish of the sea, whatever passes along the paths of the seas. O Lord, our Lord, how majestic is your name in all the earth. What a grand sovereign God we worship and serve. Good morning, happy Sunday. Love you guys.
O Lord, our Lord, how majestic is your name in all the earth.
You're staying safe and healthy during this time.
Today we're going to be reading 1 Corinthians chapter 13.
And yet I will show you the most excellent way. If I speak in the tongues of men or of angels, but do not have love, I am only a resounding gong or a clanging cymbal. If I have the gift of prophecy and can fathom all mysteries and all knowledge, and if I have a faith that can move mountains, but do not have love, I am nothing. If I give all I possess to the poor and give over my body to hardship that I may boast, but do not have love, I gain nothing.
Love is patient, love is kind. It does not envy, it does not boast, it is not proud. It does not dishonor others, it is not self-seeking, it is not easily angered, it keeps no record of wrongs. Love does not delight in evil, but rejoices with the truth. It always protects, always trusts, always hopes, always perseveres.
Love never fails, but where there are prophecies, they will cease. Where there are tongues, they will be stilled. Where there is knowledge, it will pass away. For we know in part, and we prophesy in part. But when completeness comes, what is in part disappears. When I was a child, I talked like a child. I thought like a child. I reasoned like a child. When I became a man, I put the ways of childhood behind me. For now we only see a reflection as in a mirror. Then we shall see face to face. Now I know in part, then I shall know fully, even as I am fully known.
And now these three remain, faith, hope, and love. But the greatest of these is love.
How I love the great Redeemer, who is doing so much for me. With what joy I tell the story of the love that makes them free. Till my earthly life is ended,
I will sing
songs above,
and beside the crystal sea,
more and more my soul shall be praising Jesus and his love.
Skillman Church of Christ, I hope that you are all doing well this morning. I've got to say, with all that's going on in our city and in our world, I really struggled with how to best use this time during our Sunday service. Because I feel that sometimes as a church, we can get so caught up in our sermon series or our textual passage or the events that we have going on, that sometimes it's almost as if we have blinders on and we fail to speak about real issues and real events that are affecting the lives of real people. And I don't have to say it, we all know it. This is a unique time in Dallas. It's a unique time for our nation. We had the killing of Ahmaud Arbery, then the lady in Central Park who evoked her white privilege by needlessly calling the police on an angry African-American who was just asking her to leash her dog, and then the video that surfaced of George Floyd with a knee on his neck for 8 minutes and 46 seconds. I mean, the tensions are high right now. There are protests happening about racial issues, and mind you, this is all happening during the coronavirus. And I just don't think that, if we're honest, we can ignore what's happening. And I wanted to use this time to explore how we as a spiritual community can respond, or what can we learn from this. So I didn't think a standard message this Sunday was appropriate. So I took Joe Cocker's advice and I got a little help from my friends. We set up and recorded a Zoom call with Rebecca and Ryan Cole, Bimpe and Katie McMillan, Debbie and Josue Villarreal, along with Tara and myself, to have an honest discussion about topics of race, seeing color, ideas on police reform, the statement Black Lives Matter, and also the Christian response to social justice. So during this service, we can only show you a short version of the entire conversation. The full conversation is a full hour, and we'll upload this as a separate video on YouTube a little later. And as a means to discussing this issue, we used a format called Middle Ground. And this is a good job of generating conversation. The way it works is we hear a statement, and those that agree with the statement engage in a conversation. And then after some time, those that didn't agree or didn't resonate they join in on the conversation, and it generates great discussion with honesty and vulnerability. And anyway, let's get to it. I hope you enjoy this conversation of Middle Ground. Hey, Skillman family, we're here on a Zoom call with some of our good friends here at the Skillman family. So who do we got on this call, a part of this discussion today?
Hi, everyone. It's Bimpe McMillan. I'm married to Kavian McMillan, and I've been at Skillman for 8 years.
Hello, everyone. My name is Kavian McMillan. I'm married to Bimpe, and I've been at Skillman the same amount of time.
Hi, guys. I'm Rebecca Cole. I'm married to Ryan Cole, and I believe it's been 5 years since I came to Skillman.
Yes, I'm Ryan Cole, married to Rebecca Cole, and I was waiting for her to say it so that I would know how many years we've been at Skillman.
I'm Debbie Villarreal, married to Josue. We've been at Skillman for 13 years?
Try 17.
Are you serious?
Yep, okay. We could have had a kid in college next year.
Okay.
Hi, guys. My name is Josue Villarreal. I am married to Debbie Villarreal, and yes, we've been at Skillman for 17 years, since 2003.
Hi, my name is Tara Davidson, and I am married to John Mark Davidson, and we have been at Skillman 3 years.
That's right. Hello, everyone. John Mark Davidson here, and married to Tara. And we, as I've said, we got here in December of 16, so about 3 years, I guess, we've been here. So we'll get started. How we're going to do this is we're going to have everyone turn their video off, and I'm going to read a statement. And if you agree with the statement, then you can turn your video on, and we'll have a discussion about this particular statement. If you disagree or don't resonate with the statement, then keep your video off. And later, after we've talked about it, those that have talked about it, you'll be invited in to share your input as well. So let's go ahead and turn our videos off right now, and we'll get ready for the first statement. The next statement to discuss is this. I believe our society should be colorblind. If you agree with this statement, go ahead and click the video. And if you disagree, keep the video off and we'll talk about it. One, two, three.
Hi, guys. I get the feeling that I may have misread the question because nobody else is here. I'm by myself. Do me a favor, John Mark. Go ahead and read the statement one more time.
Yeah,
just to say that I'm safe. Sure.
I believe our society should be colorblind.
So I guess the way I'm understanding the statement is more of a there's a part of me that has a little bit of a conservative value system, and so when I hear that statement, I think of people should be. I don't want to use the word judge, but they should be valued by who they are, their accomplishments, their abilities and skills, and not so much valued by the color of their skin. So that's how I hear that statement when it's made. So that's my thought on that.
Yeah. Well, let's join in the conversation. Those of us that had the camera off, and does anyone have a response to this particular statement?
I always can talk, so I will talk now, I guess. So I totally hear and understand and believe what Josue said, but I think in the way that the question is phrased of, like, should we be colorblind? Like, should we not see color? Should we ignore color? That would require you to... that's a different statement than should everybody be valued regardless of their color. Because when you live in a country that was like, that's on stolen land that of people who were murdered, built by stolen people who are not property, but were forced to become property. And then you live that out for a long time. it's just like, it's impossible to see, to just be like, you know what, y'all, tomorrow, everybody, we're not even going to refer to each other as black or white. We're just going to be people. Like, the systems in which that our society has been built on included a racial aspect.
Yeah, I mean, I think I definitely agree with what most people mean by the statement, colorblind, treating everybody the same, how they want to be treated, not treating people based on the color of their skin, more like Dr. King said, the content of your character, things of that nature. Yes, that's what we should be after as a society. I'm just one that likes to be more precise with the terms that we use. I'm not a big fan of the term colorblind. That's usually not a positive thing. Nobody strives to be colorblind when they're trying to appreciate art or beauty in life. So why would we want to be colorblind in that sense? In another sense, it also dismisses, it seems to dismiss a legacy in hundreds of years of history where color did matter. It mattered a whole heck of a lot. And then all of a sudden, we want to pretend that we're colorblind. And like I said, the positive aspects of what people mean by that, I definitely agree with. I'm on board with that. But, you know, a lot of people of color, myself, I'm not a big fan of the term because it's almost like you're sweeping under the rug so much of that history where color meant everything, just in not too far in the distant past.
Yeah, I feel like if society was colorblind, then we should all be clear in color. I mean, I even think about creation. When God created the world, I think he saw the color. He created us all in his image. I mean, I'm thinking of him creating the rainbow and not seeing the seven different colors of the rainbow. I mean, even God appreciated color. He built this world to be colorful. And so I can't imagine a society that is colorblind in the concept of what they're saying, or what they determine colorblind to mean, like valuing people and valuing beauty and seeing the differences that we have in this world and valuing, respecting and honoring that, you know? So I just can't imagine a society that doesn't choose to see the beauty in the differences that we have right now.
And isn't this what makes America so special? Yes. It's the diversity of people, a melting pot. Mm-hmm. I mean, we should be proud of who we are, the color of our skin, our culture, our ethnicity, wherever we came from. We came from all over the world. Mm-hmm. We should be proud of that, and embrace it, and, you know, learn from each other on that front. That's kind of how I'm looking at it.
Yeah, and not even just on an American, you know, I like playing with micro and macro, so just the human race, it's an all of creation, right? Whenever I hear that statement, I want to say, I believe our society should be colorful instead of color. Mm. And what Kavian said, well, and everyone really, honoring that what some people mean by it, yes. But if we skip, as Kavian pointed out so eloquently, that if all of a sudden we decide that we're going to be colorblind, how do we repair and heal and acknowledge and work through all these centuries of pain and suffering? It's like not acknowledging it, and therefore we can't move forward from it to a better place.
Beautiful. Let's move on to the next statement. And so if we wouldn't mind turning our video cameras off. The next statement is, I prefer the phrase all lives matter to Black Lives Matter. If you agree with this statement, please turn your video on. Okay, looks like no one resonated with this sentence, so let's go turn our videos on and explain our thought process behind this particular statement.
I probably struggled with this one when I was reading the list earlier. I probably struggle with this one the most, mainly because deep down I really do prefer all lives matter, but the reality is that that's not happening. that statement is a very utopian and ideal scenario. And that's not what's happening right now. And so a few days ago on Facebook, I posted an article, but as part of that I was also noting on my post saying that my preference is All Lives Matter, but until we actually live that out, for now I'm going to advocate on Black Lives Matter, because we're not there, frankly.
So I feel like when people hear the term All Lives Matter, they think that they're, or when they hear the term Black Lives Matter, they think that people are just saying Black Lives Matter only. And I'm like, that's not what is being said. You know, like, and there's been so many memes and articles and Facebook to try to explain the difference between both. And, you know, you can knock yourself out with resources. But I think I like the way someone else explained it. You know, they gave like a scenario where you're running a 5K for breast cancer awareness in the month of, when is breast cancer awareness month? October, I think. October. Yeah. And then you're running that race and someone comes in and says, well, all cancers matter. We know all cancers matter. No one is saying all cancers do not matter. But at this point, we're talking about a cancer that is affecting the lives of women, that is taking the lives of women. That's where the problem is right now. And then I've seen another meme that talks about, that likens this to the story of the parable of the lost sheep, right? There are 100 sheep, one goes missing. And Jesus leaves the 99 to go search for that one. And then the 99 are like, well, what about us? And he's like, well, y'all are okay. You're not the one in danger right now. It's this one sheep that is currently in danger. So I'm going to go look for this sheep. And so I'm like, right now, Black lives are the ones that we're seeing constantly being murdered, being treated unjustly, you know, being discriminated, being oppressed. And so we're not saying that all lives do not matter, but right now, let's solve the problem at hand right now, the Black lives that are being treated unjustly. And then when that's taken care of, which I don't even know how that could ever be taken care of, but if once we address that issue, then all lives can truly matter. Then we can finally say that, yes, all lives do matter. Does that make sense?
I just want to say one thing, too, that kind of relates these two statements. So some of you might have seen I posted on Facebook this 2-hour-long lecture, which is long, but I swear to you, if you start watching it, it's so good. Dr. Michelle Alexander wrote this book called The New Jim Crow. Rebecca?
Yes.
Haven't you had the book?
Oh, it's somewhere. I can go get it.
Oh, yeah, whatever. So she'll show it to you. But it's basically... You get a tour of our house. Yeah, there's the book.
There we go.
And it's about basically how the Jim Crow system in America codified Black people as a second-class citizen. So it was like, when I talked about the law and what's legal versus what's ethical, it was legally, if you were Black, you were a second-class citizen. And how, because we've kind of gone away from that overt racism where, like, I'm telling you because you're Black or because you're whatever, this is some derogatory thing, they had to shift, the shift was to a more inclusive thing. So because there's not a law that's like, you know what, it's okay to kill Black people and not white people if you're a police officer trying to, you know, get somebody under control, then that means that Black people, white people, everybody are allowed to be killed, if, you know, in that process. So you open the door to more people not having their lives be valued if you don't take one example and say, hey, look, if we can solve these issues and look at policy that we're trying to get passed to protect Black lives, we actually will be able to protect everybody. So that's just one thing, too, that I kind of get tripped up about, because obviously, I'm a firm believer, like, yes, Black Lives Matter. Because if I personally looked at you in the face and said, like, does my life matter as a Black person? And you start telling me, well, I mean, but technically, if you don't think my life matters, then, like, I don't know what to do for you. But, you know, like, that's something that is kind of, people take it personally. So you have to kind of take that into consideration.
Mm-hmm. Do you think that this Black Lives Matter movement came out of partially an attempt to challenge colorblindness in society, like saying this is an issue that specifically affects Black people, and please acknowledge that there are issues that specifically affect Black people, and there are issues that specifically affect Latinos, and like, you know, just acknowledge that race plays a factor in the way that we do things as a society. And so when people say all lives matter, a lot of times it does denote this inability to say, hey, I know this affects you because of your race.
Yeah, I think the phrase at its heart is an ellipsis. I think it's really Black Lives Matter too. But for rhetorical effect, Black Lives Matter. Now, I think this whole conversation has become very politicized. Mm-hmm. And I, you know, in terms of the discourse, I just want to be an arbiter, I guess, on how I view what is meant by the phrase Black Lives Matter, what is meant by the phrase All Lives Matter. I don't necessarily 100% agree with the organization Black Lives Matter on every single thing, nor do I, you know, dismiss people in hand for saying All Lives Matter, because I, once again, it's one of those things that I think people have the best of intentions when they say something like that. But just in the context of the discourse that we're talking about, once again, it's one of those things where All Lives Matter seems to be a response to Black Lives Matter. And that response appears to be to, in a sense, undermine what the intent of calling special attention to the issue at hand is, or to obfuscate the issue by making it more global in some way. So kind of like what Bempe was saying, I think the analogy is sound about, you know, if this is Breast Cancer Awareness Month, you're not dismissing other types of ailments, you're calling special attention to a particular problem. You know, in this country, we love to say God bless America, right? Does that mean that God does not bless anybody else? I don't think so. I mean, with the best of intentions, we just want to call special attention on, you know, his role in this country. Some people may mean it that way. I don't know. But the point is, I try to look at the spirit of what's being said, and to take away the momentum or the force of the phrase Black Lives Matter by immediately steering the conversation in another way, that's kind of what I object to. Do I object to the phrase All Lives Matter? Not at all, because I think that is ultimately the reality. But remember, I think it's Black Lives Matter too.
Beautiful. Let's go to the next statement. If everybody could turn their cameras off. The next statement is, as Christians, we are called to speak on issues of social justice. If you agree with this assessment, this statement, please turn your videos on. Who wants to begin?
Go into your Bible, type in justice, and it brings out a laundry list of biblical verses. That's the point. And one of them that is actually one that I really like is Isaiah 1:17. Learn to do good, seek justice, correct oppression, bring justice to the fatherless, plead the widow's cause.
You know, you could always just go back to what Jesus said were the two most important commandments. And the second one was love your neighbor as yourself. And I mean, specifically speaking from a place of whiteness,
as somebody who has racial privilege in a society, if I see that somebody else does not have that privilege and is being treated unjustly, and I do not fight for equity for them, I'm disobeying Jesus, because I'm not loving them as I love myself. Because love is not a noun. It's not just saying, oh, I feel bad for them because they are suffering from racism. It's an action. It's a verb. And, you know, you can't profess to love Jesus and follow Jesus and not love your neighbor at the same time and not fight for your neighbor at the same time. Mm-hmm. It's just, you can't. Mm-hmm. That's it for me.
I do think churches, for whatever reason, historically have a tendency of sitting on the sidelines and not be a proactive community member, if you will, of these kind of things. We just got to sit back and watch and just hope it doesn't get too crazy. We hope that the fight doesn't end up in our front yard kind of thing. We try to sit back and we genuinely just don't want to deal with it. We almost kind of like an ostrich complex where you just kind of stick your head in the ground and pretend like it's not happening. Mm-hmm. You know, but I do think that we do need to be more proactive on these things and make a decision and take a stand.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and part of me wonders why that's the case. I'm like, is it because they liken the issues of social justice to a political statement? And a lot of times, you know, churches don't want to take a political stance, or they don't want to be seen delving into politics. And I'm like, well, when it comes to social justice, that's not a political issue. That's a human rights issue. There's a higher calling than just I'm liberal versus Republican versus whatever. So I feel like churches need to take, I mean, the Bible has called us, the Lord has called us to take a stance, to show justice. I mean, I was just looking at my Bible app and, you know, Jeremiah 22 verse 3 stuck out again. It says, thus says the Lord, do justice and righteousness and deliver from the hand of the oppressor him who has been robbed, and do no wrong or violence to the resident alien, the fatherless and the widow, nor shed innocent blood in this place. So I feel like time and time again, the Bible just keeps making reference to justice, to mercy, to looking out for those who are oppressed. And I just feel like that, I mean, who better to do that than the church?
Mm. Yeah, that's a great question. Why haven't we done that, right? Like, why have we had our head in the sand a lot of times, like an ostrich, you know, and not stepped up? And I think, black churches, I think they've done a better job than predominantly white churches have. You know, number one, because I think the system itself has been working towards, you know, the whiteness. And I think so there hasn't been a need to, we haven't felt the heat to really challenge the system. And secondly, is I think that we, in as a church, we don't like things messy, right? We kind of like things orderly. We kind of want to know the three things or the four things and the five things. Then we want to leave and have lunch and have all you can eat buffet and then get on with our life. But I think if we can let go of that and realize that spirituality and this conversation, it's going to be messy. It's a beautiful mess, but it allows us on the other side to grow and learn from each other. And so we can dive in to these issues. And I feel, you know, the statement I think was that the church should be about social justice. I feel like the church should be the leaders in social justice. I think Christians, based on our theology, on the fact that all humans, every single human being with a heartbeat, with blood going through their veins, every single one is God, is created in God's image. Every single one. And I think that is ingrained in our theology. So when Rebecca says, love your neighbor as yourself, when we see our neighbor in pain, when we see our neighbor not being listened to, a neighbor who is voiceless, you know, I feel like that is where the voice of spirituality of Christianity comes in, and we proclaim that everyone is in God's image and every life matters, every single one.
If you look at politics and sort of the etymology of the word, it's like affairs of the citizens. And man, it would be, I think we would all be really hard pressed to not say that Jesus was very involved in the affairs of the people. In a way that he really looked out for those on the margins. Not for power of an empire, not in the empire sense, but for the people as individuals and as a whole, recognizing that we're all connected. I think Bimpe and I were talking the other day, I really like the phrase of like, phrases like there's no such thing as anyone else's children. Like we all belong to each other. And I think Jesus really exemplified that in living that out in his life. And if we look to him, if that's what we call Christianity, then how can we not? How can we not be involved and speak out and take action in whatever way we can and are able to work towards justice and to fight injustice?
Mm-hmm. One issue may be one of translation and interpretation as well. In the New Testament or throughout the Bible, the word justice and the word righteousness are the same word in Greek. And so we've preferred the word righteousness, which is a good word too, but we've kind of made it this religious thing that belongs in a category of personal excellence. Whereas justice is not only your personal moral excellence, but it's, you know, in a sense, excellence in how we treat other people as well. Mm-hmm. So maybe when we see the word righteousness, that we can expand our understanding of that, or hyphenate righteousness, justice, you know, where that becomes the core idea in our mind, that it's not just our moral excellence, which I'm not saying to discard with that, but also excellence in how we treat our neighbor, excellence in how we love one another. You know, those are the great commands. So we've kind of over-spiritualized, but not just over-spiritualized, over-individualized certain words in the Bible. And we need to get back to what the church is meant to be, is, you know, interpersonal as well, not just the personal relationship with God, but the way that we treat our brothers and sisters.
Hey, what a great conversation it's been. Can I give you guys a virtual hug right now? I love all of you guys, and I love all you people, because guys and gals. And this has been an incredible conversation, so thank you so much for your thoughts, and may God bless you all, this city, Dallas, this season that we're all in, and may we emerge from this time better as a people. A special thanks to Ryan, Rebecca, Bimpe, and Kavian, Debbie, and Josue, and Tara for participating in this conversation. If you have their number, shoot them a text of encouragement, because you know, these issues, they're hard to talk about sometimes, and I'm grateful. I think we're all grateful for their honesty, their vulnerability, their ability to articulate concepts in a clear way. And also, please look for an email from the church with a link to the full video. That's an hour. But for now, let's continue with our service. We have Christy and Tim Garcia, who are going to lead us in a communion meditation. And finally, David Griffin will close us out with a shepherd's blessing. Let's sing together.
Father, we love you, we worship and adore you,
Skillman Church. We live in a broken and divided world. We see rejection, exclusion, divisions everywhere we look, racial, political, and gender. But we are called to unity. In Galatians 3, 26 to 28, it says, "For you are all children of God through faith in Christ Jesus. And all who have been united with Christ in baptism have put on Christ, like putting on new clothes. There is no longer Jew or Gentile, slave or free, male and female. For you are all one in Christ Jesus."
We've been united through Christ. We are all broken, but Jesus calls us to him. He calls us to come to the table. He invites us to share a meal with him. Because of his invitation, his grace and mercy, we owe him something. I'll be reading from 1 Corinthians 11, 17 through 21. "But in the following instructions, I do not commend you, because when you come together, it is not for the better, but for the worse. For in the first place, when you come together as a church, I hear that there are divisions among you, and I believe it in part. For there must be factions among you in order that those who are genuine among you may be recognized. When you come together, it is not the Lord's Supper that you eat. For in eating, each one goes ahead with his own meal. One goes hungry, another gets drunk." And now I'll skip down to verse 27. "Whoever therefore eats the bread or drinks the cup of the Lord in an unworthy manner will be guilty concerning the body and blood of the Lord. Let a person examine himself then, and so eat of the bread and drink of the cup. For anyone who eats and drinks without discerning the body eats and drinks judgment on himself."
And how do we honor Christ? We strive to make sure there are no divisions, no rejection, no exclusions. We love each other and take care of each other. Isaiah 1:17 says, "Learn to do good, seek justice, help the oppressed, defend the cause of orphans, fight for the rights of widows." And Jeremiah 22:3 says, "This is what the Lord says, be fair-minded and just, do what is right, help those who have been robbed, rescue them from their oppressors, quit your evil deeds, and do not mistreat foreigners, orphans, and widows. Stop murdering the innocent." Let's pray for the bread. Lord, we thank you for your Son, who saved us from our brokenness and calls us to this table. We are all equally broken and equally in need of your mercy and grace. Because of this, give us the courage and endurance to run the good race, doing what is good, seeking justice, and helping the oppressed. Amen.
Jesus, we love you, we worship and adore you, glorify thy name in all the earth, glorify thy name.
I'll be reading from Colossians 3, 10 through 14. "Do not lie to one another, seeing that you have put off the old self with its practices, and have put on the new self, which is being renewed in knowledge after the image of its creator. Here there is not Greek and Jew, circumcised and uncircumcised, barbarian, Scythian, slave, free, but Christ is all and in all. Put on then, as God's chosen ones, holy and beloved, compassionate hearts, kindness, humility, meekness, and patience, bearing with one another, and if one has a complaint against another, forgiving each other. As the Lord has forgiven you, so you also must forgive. And above all these, put on love, which binds everything together in perfect harmony. Pray with me for the cup. Father, we thank you that you've united us and given us one hope. Father, I pray that you will make our hearts humble and tender. Please help us to commune with one another in spirit and in truth. We pray all these things in Jesus' name. Amen.
Spirit, we love you, we worship and adore you, glorify thy name in all the earth, glorify thy name.
Morning. For this week's blessing, I want to read, recite a prayer, a liturgy that was sent to me earlier this week that I found very, very helpful, very insightful, even profound in its words, timely for the situation that we're in right now. So as we begin this blessing, I would ask that you would bow your heads as I pray. Christ our King, our world is overtaken by unexpected calamity and by a host of attending fears and worries and insecurities. We witness suffering, confusion, and hardship multiplied around us, and we find ourselves swept up in these same anxieties and troubles, dismayed by so many uncertainties. Now we turn to you, O God, in this season of our common distress. Be merciful, O Christ, to those who suffer, to those who worry, to those who grieve, to those who are threatened or harmed in any way by this upheaval. Let your holy compassions be active throughout the world even now, tending the afflicted, comforting the brokenhearted, and bringing hope to many who are hopeless. Use even these hardships to woo our hearts nearer to you, O God. Indeed, our Father, may these days of disquiet become a catalyst for conviction and repentance, for the tendering of our affections, for the stirring of our sympathies, for the repining of our love. We are your people, who are called by you. We need not be troubled or alarmed. Indeed, O Lord, let us love now more fearlessly, remembering that you created us and appointed us to live in these very places in the midst of these unsettled times. It is no surprise to you that we are here now, sharing in this turmoil along with the rest of our society, for you have called your children to live as salt and light among the nations, praying and laboring for the flourishing of the communities where we dwell, acting as agents of your forgiveness, salvation, healing, reconciliation, and hope in the very midst of our often troubled world. And in these vocations, you have not left us helpless, O Lord, because you have not left us at all. Your Spirit remains among us. Inhabit now your church, O Spirit of the risen Christ. Unite and equip your people for the work before them. Father, empower your children to live as your children. In times of distress, let us respond, not as those who would instinctively entrench for our own self-preservation, but rather as those who, in imitation of their Lord, would move in humble obedience toward the needs and hurts of their neighborhoods and communities. You were not ashamed to share in our sufferings, Jesus. Let us now be willing to share in yours, serving as your visible witnesses in this broken world. Hear now these words, you children of God, and be encouraged. Be greatly encouraged. The Lord's throne in heaven is yet occupied. His rule is eternal, and his good purposes on earth will be forever accomplished. So we need never be swayed by the brief and passing panics of this age. You are the King of the ages, O Christ, and history is held in your Father's hands. We, your people, know the good and glorious end of this story. Our heavenly hope is secure, and in this time of widespread suffering, then let us rest afresh in the surpassing peace of that vision. The vision that your whole church on earth might be liberated to love more generously and sacrificially. Now labor in and through us, O Lord, extending and multiplying the many expressions of your mercy. Amen.
To Canaan's land, I'm on my way, where the soul of man never dies. My darkest night will turn to day, where the soul of man never dies. Dear friends, there'll be no sad farewell, there'll be no tear-dimmed eyes. Where all is peace and joy and love, and the soul of man never dies. A rose is blooming there for me, where the soul of man never dies. And I will spend eternity where the soul of man never dies. Dear friends, there'll be no sad farewell, there'll be no tear-dimmed eyes. Where all is peace and joy and love, and the soul of man never dies. I'm on my way to that fair land where the soul of man never dies. Where there will be no parting hand, and the soul of man never dies. Dear friends, there'll be no sad farewell, there'll be no tear-dimmed eyes. Where all is peace and joy and love, and the soul of man never dies.